Hello and welcome back to the 10 Go to 10 show. My name is the other guy. I have in the studio with me the bassist for a local group, Red Baron. His name is Mark Lynch. Before we get into the interview, though, I just want to read back what I've been playing for the last 45 minutes or so. You just heard from Aphex Twin and his track Didgeridoo off of his Classics album. And before that, we heard a couple of tracks off of My Bloody Valentine's Loveless album. We heard Only Shadow and Loomer. Starting off the set, we heard from Psychic Warriors of Gaia and their track Of the Monad. Also heard Underworld with Please Help Me from the Push Upstairs single. Also a couple of tracks from Alice Cooper, believe it or not. We heard Years Ago and Steven, Boot Sauce with Love Monkey Number 9, and Soothing Sounds for Baby, another local group, and their track New Year's Restoration. And that's pretty much what you heard. And let's all give a big welcome to Mark Lynch.
Hello, Rick. Hello, everyone.
How you doing, Mark?
Very well. Thanks for having me on.
Yeah, no, it was really good. Glad you could make it down. I know you have places to go in a little bit, but just hoping maybe you could stick around for maybe a half hour or so and
no
tell
problem.
Us a little about your band.
We'd love to.
How did you guys form? Did you guys already know each other beforehand? Or?
Well, originally, in terms of my involvement, I was in a group called Thirsty Souls with Rob Palange, who's one of our guitarists now, and Michael Kamen, the drummer.
You guys actually had a couple of different names, right, besides that?
It can be real confusing, because even before that, Rob and Mike were in a band with our current singer, Chuck, and
it gets pretty
it gets
crazy.
Really confusing. It's basically, what we're at now is a combination of a couple of, three bands, actually. Grain, Thirsty Souls, we combined those to make Mood Swing, and then we turned ourselves into Red Baron, and then got another guitarist, and then one of the third guitarist left, so now we're a five-piece again, and now we're still Red Baron. It's confusing. And actually, the new guitarist in Red Baron used to be the bassist in Grain, Jim Gallagher, so it gets a little confusing.
Wow.
That's about over the past 3 years, and they were all Winthrop-based bands, and Mood Swing was the band out of Grain and Thirsty Souls. Mood Swing was probably the most successful, I guess, for lack of a better term. We had a lot of gigs last year.
Yeah, some of the songs from the Thirsty Souls era, weren't those sort of brought up into your current playlist?
Actually, it was Mood Swing demo. The four songs on the Mood Swing demo are now on our Red Baron CD, and they're remixed.
Oh, I see.
So those four, and then we recorded six more, so put them all together, we have 10.
And those were actually recorded here in Winthrop, too, right?
Right.
In the local studio?
Yep, Chris Morano.
Yep, great guy.
Yeah, very nice guy, a really talented musician and producer.
You can say hello.
Yeah, hello, Chris. Chris is my guru. Chris, I took lessons from Chris, and he, as does Rob Palange, who's in our band.
Yeah.
I actually
saw Chris on, I think, one of Bill's talk shows a couple of years ago, and he seemed like he really, really was a good guy.
Oh, yeah. He's really very knowledgeable.
Yep.
And he's a very positive person, and that makes for a good atmosphere, both if you're taking lessons or if you're in the studio. He always pushes you to do a little better. And he expects, the thing with Chris that I really like is he expects a lot out of you, but he gets a lot out of you. You know, if he knows you can do it, he doesn't settle for you not doing it. He really pushes
you. Yeah.
And that's a really good thing, and that makes you a better musician and everything, and you get better songs because of that and everything else. So the band and myself greatly owe a big debt to Chris.
Now, did he work individually with each of you? Did he, like, pull you aside each and say what you shouldn't be doing?
Recording, you mean?
Yeah.
We did it, well, the four songs that I mentioned that we originally did on the Mood Swing demo, those were basically, we just jammed all together, and we kept the best take.
Okay.
So that was a little different than those six songs we did to put with the other four. We recorded the bass and the drums. Me and Mike on one day did that in a scratch vocal track and a scratch guitar track. And then a lot of the guitar solos were done overdubbed, and a lot of the vocals were overdubbed. If something happened to be good in the scratch, actually, some of the rhythm tracks were actually kept from the scratch. I can remember clearly Walden, Lazarus, probably a couple others, I can't remember off the top of my head, were kept. So that was a long process, the other six songs, both recording and mixing.
No, it was, I think it was Justin Solomon's show that I saw you guys on.
Right, when he had his show Burnt Toast, he had us on.
You sounded really, really good. Sounded really tight.
Yeah, it's always a challenge down WCAT in terms of, because it's really not made for a venue for music, so.
Yeah, but you definitely did the best at what you had.
Right, you don't have a mixing board,
so,
you don't have a lot of stuff that, you know, a lot of times you get, but you do the best you can. We tried, and that was the beginning.
Weren't you actually trying to record the show onto a computer
right.
And the thing died or something?
Right, which we weren't even aware of, but Dave Chase, who was playing keyboards, was taping. See, I'm still in the 80s, people.
That's
one
okay.
It's one of my flaws.
That's okay. We're actually taping this, so.
But, recording digitally on CD, I don't even know. Rick, help me. How would you phrase that? Digitally recording it. And so Dave was doing that. I guess something happened. We were all obviously looking the other way because we were playing out to some people, so we didn't see behind us, but I guess, I guess a couple of songs came out, and then one of them didn't or something. It's always fun.
I think there's even a bootleg, CD 3 of whatever was actually recovered off of that is still floating around somewhere.
Yeah. Playing live is always an adventure.
And by the way, you used my real name, Mark.
Oh, I'm sorry.
that's okay.
You go by the other guy?
You could just call me Tog.
All right, Tog.
No. it's really cool though to see how you guys all sort of mix and match. I always thought of Winthrop, you know, wouldn't it be great Winthrop becoming sort of like a Liverpool in its own right, you know? it's just really fun. I'm really up on seeing the local bands and what people are doing. And of course that's why I'd like to, you know, I wanted you on the show. I guess we should start off, you know, take a little break. We'll hear a song off of your album, which they have a full CD out. If you want to explain a little about, you know, what the title.
Sure.
Where they can get it.
Yeah, I mean, obviously, if you keep your eyes open, if you read the Boston Phoenix, by the time this is coming out, we'll have a show. We have a show on June 17th at the Linwood Grill in Boston.
We'll actually talk about that.
All right.
Next little
section. Keep your eyes open. You can buy them at any of our shows. You can also, if you want to, do you have an email address or anything that people could send a question?
Yeah, actually, if you want to get it through this show, you can contact, go click on the website, www.winthropma.com. Click on the WCAT icon, and then click on the feedback section, and you can leave it that way.
You could even email me. I mean, I have no problem doing this. I have my email address is lynchmob, one word, lynchmob88@hotmail.com. And anyone have any comments or anything about any of the songs you hear, any questions when we're playing next or whatever, feel free to drop me a line. It'd be great to hear from anybody.
Are you consigning to, like, different record stores yet? Or
we're in the process of doing that. It's kind of involved.
Yeah, I've had
People will tell you, oh, you got to talk to this person, that person, and they're never there, and it's a long process. We're trying to do that.
It's also tough to keep track of, you know, who's sold what already. It's you have to really be pretty dedicated to.
And it's almost just good PR to do that, more so than getting these amazing record sales. I mean,
right.
You can have, you know, right. You might your CDs might be there for 6 months. You might sell two, but
exactly.
but you're out there. People see it,
yep.
And they see your name. They might remember it, you know. And then they might be reading the Phoenix or the Calendar magazine or whatever, and see
right.
your name, and be like, oh, I know them. They're from Winthrop. Why don't I go check them out? So,
well, the track that we're gonna listen to is Lazarus, I believe. That's the one we're gonna listen to. It's track 5. So give a listen, and we'll be back in about 4 minutes. You are listening to the Tango to Ten show right here on WCAT, Winthrop Community Access Television. Stay tuned.
mom. Here I make a stand. Ignorance is overrated. Tolerance is understated. Lazarus, I'm back from the dead. I walk with all this dread. Rise once again next week. What's on the other side? Look at this walking creek. Women faint, the babies cry. Jackpot in a case. Another soul to save. On display the human race. Here I'll attempt to pray. Ignorance is overrated. Tolerance is understated.
Was just Lazarus by a local group called Red Baron. We're actually here right now with the bassist from Red Baron, Mark Lynch. Mark, how long have you been playing bass?
Only a little over 2 years.
Wow.
Yeah, I took definitely a crash course.
Wow, would definitely sound more experienced than that.
Well, I to be honest with you, I had a great teacher, as we mentioned earlier, and I practiced really, really hard. And you can't, there's no substitute for practice. I mean,
every day, right?
Every day. I practice every day, no lie. And yep. There's something, it's really different. I think when you pick an instrument up when you're a little older, I think you really have more dedication to it, especially if it's like your money that's paying for the lesson and your money that bought the amp and your money that bought the bass. So, yeah, I really wanted to learn. And there were times at the beginning where I got discouraged and stupid things just like hand, you know, moving your hand around the fretboard. It's a lot of work, and but you definitely see results if you work hard at it.
Definitely. Now, the board of the name of the album is actually called Board of Health, B-O-R-E-D. Is that some sort of like an in joke between?
Yeah,
them?
It's an in joke.
Or are you seriously like sick of being healthy or something?
I think it's both.
Is that something that you do not wish to disclose?
Well, yeah, it's basically an in joke, and we'll leave it at that.
Okay.
But we had some other ideas for the album cover, which.
Bands love in-jokes.
Yeah, the whole thing is the name of the band, the album, and we'll leave that to the mystery. If you come to our show and you ask me, or anyone in the band what it means, we'll tell you. But that's a way we'll get people to go to the show. Now, no one would get it anyway. So it's just, and people think it was stupid anyway, so it doesn't matter.
Now, I think we briefly touched on your lineup, your band lineup, and how there were different personnel changes over the how many years actually has it been that you guys have been together as Red Baron? Has it been almost two?
Well, it's been
it's longer than that.
Well, the current lineup of Red Baron, which is myself, Chuck, Rob, Jimmy, and Mike.
Chuck is the vocalist.
Chuck's on vocals, right?
Yep.
Rob's on guitar. Jim's on guitar. Jim, however, did not perform on the album. Mm-hmm. He wasn't in the band at the time. Paul D'Annunzio actually played the other. Him and Rob basically split lead duties,
right,
and rhythm duties on the album. But Paul's no longer with the band.
Yeah, I when I saw you guys at the Phoenix, by the way, I just thought that the energy level for that night was just really, really, like, tremendous.
Yeah, we had a great time.
And that, yeah, I mean, actually, to go off on a tangent, what would you say would be the best show that you guys have performed? Like, which particular?
You know, it's really hard. There's certain shows, it's like you feel the energy's there. Other shows, you think you played better.
Yeah. Well, there are a lot of factors.
There's a ton
too,
of factors. How you personally feel like you played. And sometimes if you feel like you didn't play that well, then it might get you down. But you got to, band-wise,
right,
overall, maybe the Phoenix show would probably be the best.
Yeah, I was actually going to say, I was going to rephrase that a little bit and say, which show do you, as a band, not
mm-hmm,
counting the outside factors, but just how you guys felt as a unit, did you feel had the best vibe, I guess, to for lack of a better word?
Yeah,
with
and
the
they
Phoenix,
were
which is
probably overall the Phoenix.
I could definitely feel, you know, even out in the audience, I could feel, you know, mm-hmm, the high energy level.
Oh yeah,
and that was a pretty long show too. That was,
oh yeah, we
had
to come up
had a,
with
had a,
over 2 hours worth of material. Which
we had a break.
Someone said the Stones don't have 2 hours of material, and we had, you know, at the time we hadn't even we didn't even have all the songs we have now. We did a lot more covers. We did some REM.
You did Desperado.
We did, yeah. We did some Eagles. We did all sorts of stuff to fill in the gaps.
Yeah.
But we had a really good time. We all get along really well, and I think that comes out as well. Like, we have good chemistry. The five of us that are in the band now, we're all really focused. We all are on the same page, and I think that goes a long way. And that goes for anything. I mean, certain bands, they're not, you know, just current bands out there. They might not be the greatest on their instruments per se, but you put them all together, and if they have really good songwriting, then that can carry you as much as, you know. I mean, I like jazz as much as anybody, but you know, sometimes a great song is three chords and a great chorus. You know what I mean?
That's all it takes. Just ask AC/DC.
Exactly. They've been doing it for, what, 25, 30 years
and
by
it
now.
Still works.
Exactly. Some of the best stuff is just chemistry and how you get on with the other people in the band. And, of course, talent, of course, has a lot to do with it. But there are a lot of things that make a great show and a great band.
Now, Jim Gallagher wasn't at that show, to get back to the original, what we were talking
about. No, Paul was still in the band for that Phoenix show. Jim actually has made a big change. He's really, at heart, a bassist, and we always joke about that because I play bass too. So, but he has been playing guitar now for quite a few, several months at least. And he's always messed around on the guitar, but now he's really, when Paul wasn't in the band anymore, we really thought about what we wanted, and again, I just go back to what I said. Jim is a good guitarist, and he's a great guy, and he knew the songs. He wanted to be in the band, and he's willing to learn us on material. And it's tough to be a new person in a band. And I mean, he's a real trooper, and he really participated in getting the albums out. He chipped in.
Yeah.
I mean, I have nothing but positive things to say about Jim. All the guys in the band really.
Yeah.
I mean, the five of us now, we're really clicking, and we're real excited to start playing out again.
It's tough to have to fill someone else's shoes.
It is, and Paul's a great guitar player. It just didn't work, and that happens. That happens all the time in music, and well as life in general. And as I said, Paul's a really good guitarist, and You know, and that's another thing, too, is some of the songs live are going to sound a little different because on the album, as I mentioned, Paul's the other guitarist, and now it's Jim playing guitar. Rob is now taking over all the leads, and Jim is the rhythm player. So that's a little different. Before, I mean...
So Rob used to do rhythm, and Rob, now Jim is doing the rhythm.
Rob and Paul used to split the duties between rhythm and lead.
I see.
Now it's Rob doing all the lead, and Jim does all the rhythm.
So would you say that the sound has changed since the original?
Somewhat. We've tried to keep the main. You know, I mean, obviously we're all in the same key, so the notes here and there might be a little different, but overall it's the same.
Same.
And we felt like that was important. And Rob, and there's another thing. Rob had to really work hard to learn the leads for all the songs that Paul played. You know, I had a problem. Me, Chuck, and Mike had it the easiest when Paul wasn't in the band. And Jim and Rob really had to make some changes and work really hard, and they did. And it shows now. When you see us live, you'll see it. We the hard work is paying off. And again, nothing. It goes like I was talking about earlier. When you learn an instrument, it just takes tons of practice. And no one realizes it when you see bands how much work. I can't even tell you how much work goes into stuff. I mean, you just.
No,
you know
what, just the little stuff that I do.
And when you're dealing with like five different people, it's just hard to get all on the same page. But we try our best, and you know, we've gotten a lot of positive response to the album, so we're happy about that. And we all of us bring something different to the band. We all have a little different musical taste, and I think everyone always asks who we sound like, and I can't tell them.
Well,
we really have our own sound. A lot of people say that, but I think we really do.
No, that's the thing. Actually, I was going to ask or mention is that, like, the difference between like your song "Mondays and Alibis" and the song, say, "Walden,"
right?
Which both I've played on past shows is like phenomenal. It's just amazing the difference. I mean, "Mondays and Alibis" has sort of like almost like a Pink Floydian kind of sound, whereas "Walden" is like, I don't know, I don't like. Like 70s, like country rock almost? Sort
yeah,
of?
It could be on like the River 92.5.
Yeah, exactly.
Something
in
like
fact,
that.
In fact, that's what I said when I listened to the album. I said, this is the song that could get on the air.
You know, definitely.
This is the song that they would pull first.
Right. And I tend to. It's hard because you want to stay true to your sound, and that's one side of us. We have a lot of different sides. Like the song that just played is Lazarus, more of a kicking song.
Right.
And the next song that we're going to play is Mesh, and that's really kicker too. And then you have the Walden and the Mondays. I mean, it's really, we have a lot of sides to us. And again, that reflects the different people in the band and stuff like that. So I think it's important to have a little diversity versatility.
That way is always changing up. It's not growing stale. The listener can expect to hear something new every time and not say, because after a while you almost like, you almost say to yourself, wow, this so-and-so is actually sounding like so-and-so themselves, you know, because they're becoming almost like, you know, almost like a, not a cliche, but, you
know, the great thing about it, too,
themselves or
the really cool thing is when we sit down and write a song, we don't even really talk about what we're going to do. We just kind of do it. And what you hear is we don't try to say, well, what's hip right now? What do we want to sound like?
You're just doing your
own thing.
We just
play it. We just write it.
Exactly.
And it's funny because... And this may sound really weird, but individually speaking, if all of us were going to pick like one group, it would probably be something a little different than what Red Baron sounds like in terms of each individual's favorite kind of music. But when we all come together, that's what we come up with. It's really weird. And the songwriting process, which maybe, I don't know if you're going to ask me about that later, but yeah, one of us will come in with an idea. And we just stop playing it or pick a key or whatever and just come up with an idea.
Right.
And then someone else will work on it. And then once I know the chord changes, if it's someone else's riff, then I'll try to think of something cool with the bass, like a fill or a scale or a run to do or how to connect the different chords. And you just try to keep it different. Like Lazarus, the last song, it's a pretty that's probably one of my most complicated bass lines. It's a lot of notes in there.
Well, I personally believe, you know, in the same philosophy as what you were just describing about how you kind of work off of each other to come up with the final product.
Right. And then you
refine it and get it down to something that can be recorded.
Exactly, and a lot of, as in any band, sometimes you know some person might want something a little different here, but you go with what the band wants and what in the context of the band sounds the best. And again, that's a challenge of being in a band. It's something you know you keep your mind open and your ears open,
right.
And you respect what other people in the band are telling you and other people that are listening that might get a chance to hear it, and you just go from there. And that goes a long way with a band is how you treat each other, and I think it's. What we have now is the five of us really do respect each other and we listen to each other, and I think it's real important.
Yeah, that's what makes a band last.
Definitely.
So let's get into the song we were just talking about, Mesh. This is track 3 off of their Board of Health album. We'll be back in a little bit.
Find myself wishing for more. Buying love for a small fee. I ask myself if there is more. Running far from pain when it takes a stage. Stay behind when heroes think they save the day. Out the gun, I won't hurt anyone. Feeling the rain, I just let all my patience go. Stealing all the days we shared, I find myself wishing for more. Buying love for a small fee, I ask myself if there.
Listening to the Tango to 10 show right here on WCAT. We're here right now with the bassist from a local group, Red Baron. They just came out with a new CD entitled Board of Health. That song, Mark, that was Mesh.
Yes.
Now, what would be, what is the process that you would have for a song like that that you did have? I don't know how to really.
I know, just saying, kind of like, how do we write a song? In a way, yeah. How does it start? Well, what happens
you,
usually?
You briefly touched on it, how you all sort of work off of each.
Right.
Each other, like one person
right.
starts with like
right.
the first layer.
The music,
and then
almost all 95% of the time comes first. One of us. Come up with a riff. Yep.
Does Chuck actually come up with his own lyrics, or does someone else write them?
Rob and Chuck write the lyrics. Mostly Chuck.
Does it give credit?
Like, for instance, no.
Because it's all songs
we keep
written by
right.
Barrett,
we think it's real important because all of us contribute something. Even if, like, for instance, the first song that you played, Lazarus, Rob wrote the music and the lyrics to that. But he came in, he played it. We sat down, we all listened to it. He played it and kind of hummed the melody and the words along with it. And then we all tried it together. And again, as I mentioned, then you have the basic structure of the song, and then whoever comes up with the idea, everyone in the band has their own free reign to try to do whatever they want to with it. For instance, you know, then you think of what notes you're going to play that fit the song. So everyone contributes, you know what I mean? And then the second song that you just played, Mesh, that was, I think...
Wasn't that the first of the new material
right.
after the demo tape?
Yes, that was, I think Rob thought of that opening riff. I thought of the chord changes in the verse. Me and Rob both thought of the chorus. Chuck wrote the lyrics. Mike, the drummer, Kamen, has an excellent ear. He probably has the best ear out of the whole band. And then he also puts his two cents in and listens to it and tells us if it all sounds right, you know, if, what his opinion of it is. And then we all just play it. I mean, it's our total team effort. It really is. That's just that one song. I just named four of us that were involved in that. And the only reason Jimmy wasn't involved is because he wasn't in the band yet.
The great thing about you guys is that you really seem to be having a lot of fun on stage. Like, you don't have, you know, your backs to the audience. You're not, like, coughing up blood and throwing it on people.
No.
You're just up there. You're having a good time. And, a person such as Mike, your drummer, I noticed from seeing him on several different shows is that he essentially smiles.
he does.
The drummer is smiling, really is having fun.
Yeah, Mike's a great force to have in the band.
He's very,
very
positive. Positive
exactly.
is the exact same word I was going to use.
And he's a real talented guy. He played. He can play keyboard. He does the drums. He can play guitar. He can do any. Michael's a great person for the group.
He was playing keyboard on Desperado.
Yes, he was, and also on Mondays and Alibis on the album.
Yep.
If you listen, there's just some keyboard work in that. Yeah, I mean, all of us bring something to the table. We really do. We all put our own stamp on every song, I think.
Now, I had mentioned earlier the fact that, you know, a song like Mondays and Alibis, which is actually one of my favorites, and, you know, it reminded me sort of a Pink Floyd song.
Right.
And then Walden sort of reminded me of sort of like, I don't want to say the Eagles because I'm not really sure if that's where I want to go with that. But
it's almost, if you want something from the 90s, almost like Soul Asylum, maybe.
Sort of, yeah.
Early 90s.
I guess that would be.
You know, I don't know, something like that.
Yeah, the early 90s.
It's really hard. I mean, like
a few
I said,
years ago? No, yeah. That was 9 years ago, right?
I know. Time's flying.
But were those sort of some of the influences on those particular,
yeah.
not just those, but what are sort of some of your background influences?
Well, it's funny because we all kind of represent a different era in music in the band. Chuck Walsh, the singer, and Jim are about the same age. We're all a couple years. We all, like, me and Rob are the oldest in the band.
You're sort of on the cusps of different generations,
right.
Almost.
Like, but Rob is a real classic rock and roller. He likes the Allman Brothers. Neil Young. Nowadays, he likes Dave Matthews. I'm more of the metalhead of the group. I grew up listening to Ozzy and Van Halen and Motley Crue.
Dokken.
And I can't say I don't have one.
Dokken. I've seen that collection, and I am actually impressed.
I know. I have everything. I listen to a lot of different stuff. But anyway.
And in fact, just to quickly mention, a little bit further on in the show, we will actually hear a sample of his.
My strange music collection.
Yes. Anything goes on the Tango to Tencho.
Yeah, and so I like all that stuff, sometimes a little hotter stuff. Jim and Chuck, the other guitarist, and Chuck's the singer, they're in the early 20s. They're kind of from the grunge era. They like stuff like Pearl Jam, Stone Temple Pilots, stuff like that. And Mike, the drummer, who is the youngest in the band, he's still in college, but he, ironically enough, is another classic rocker. The Eagles.
Isn't he also jazz influenced, though?
And he also likes jazz a lot. Not to say I don't like any STP, because I do, or to say Rob doesn't like any metal, or
right.
You know, Mike, you know, whatever. We all, certain stuff we all like, but, you know, a majority, like if I had to pick five albums, it'd be different than the five albums Rob would pick if we were stuck on a desert island, or Chuck would pick, or whatever. So it's always fun when we pick songs to cover.
So you're essentially all bringing almost an entirely different genre of music.
Right. Like the audience has just heard two of our songs, and the song we've been playing lately at our shows is Come Together by the Beatles for a cover.
Wow.
So we're pretty flexible. You know, we keep everyone entertained with some different variety, and that's what happens. Anything goes. Kind of like your show, Rick.
Anything goes.
You have a great show, by the way.
Oh, thank you. Yeah, we're actually on show number 19.
I think it started
way back in January.
I think it's important what you do in terms of more independent stuff, because what people are fed today by MTV and the radio is what's hip now, and I just think it's disgusting, actually.
It is.
It really is. I hate to say it, but I think the music scene today is disgusting, because you're basically force-fed stuff.
And whatever's popular.
Right, whatever's popular now is rammed down your throat 300 times, eventually, it happens to me even. Eventually, I'll find myself tapping my foot to a song. When the first 10 times I heard it, I'm like, this is terrible. Get this off. and then I'll end up, well, I guess I like it now.
Yep.
And then everyone's always scared what someone else thinks, so they all like the same, you know.
Right.
And that goes for rock, too, as well as top 40 pop and
anything.
Heavy music, everything.
I try to stay away from, like, political arenas, but every once in a while, especially at, like, say, work, where we have to listen to the radio in our offices on all day long, and... Mm-hmm. It doesn't matter which station, we've tried them all on the FM dial and, you know, above the college stations, and because we can't get the college stations in because our antenna is terrible, but they all are repetitive no matter what. I mean, there's that new 93.7, and that's even after a week, that
it's
is gone.
Kiss 108 circa 1984, you know?
Yeah, which was actually, I was actually like, wow, Shannon, you know, let the music play, but
it
now I hear
memories,
it like, right.
Yeah.
You know... Nostalgia is like comes in waves, not like full, you know, all the time, you know, frontal assault. But I totally agree. And I actually joked on several different shows about, you know, anything goes on this show except for the five songs that are played ad nauseum on, you know, over and over on Kiss 108, which, you know, you will not hear Cher on the show. You know, you... It's
exactly.
just
thank God.
It's just bad, and I just try and give a little slice of all the different kinds of music, old and new. It doesn't matter.
Right.
I mean, it's essentially electronic, but you know, I played Alice Cooper on this show.
I
played stuff like King's X, Aerosmith. I even played old Aerosmith. You know, it doesn't. It doesn't matter. As long as you're getting. A variety, and variety is the key to everything. And you definitely have a very eclectic sampling of your music on this particular album. You were going to say something?
I was going to say, a lot of times I'll play a song for someone, and I won't purposely, I'll just say, just listen to the song. I won't even tell them who it's by, because of all the way the media does things, you have all these preconceived notions of what someone's going to sound like. And someone's like, wow, that's them, or... Who co-wrote that with them? Who produced that or whatever? Like, yeah, they all know each other, or they know this, or this one knows that one, or
wow, that's
whatever.
That's Motley Crue, you know?
Right. It's like the guy from, you know, Frontline Assembly did that, you know, whatever. And
oh, I was
stuff
I was
like that.
Very impressed.
And people have, and it's no one's really fault, but people have a lot of preconceived notions, and I'm I can be as guilty of it at times as anyone else. You have preconceived notions of things, and then when you hear the name of a group, and I think it's terrible. And I think there's a lot of great stuff out there that no one ever hears because MTV or when they're actually playing videos or the radio just doesn't play them.
They have that one popular album, yeah, and then their fame goes down.
Right. Or it's on at 2 in the morning.
Yeah, exactly, and you never hear of the other albums. But listen, we're kind of running low on tape here. Yes, we still use tape here. But let's just go back to the upcoming shows. Now, you have a show coming up tomorrow, actually, so you actually, listeners probably won't know about that until since the show's
unfortunately.
We actually pre-taped this, believe it or not.
Yep, this isn't live, unfortunately.
This is taped actually during the day on a remote island.
Yeah, MTV Island with Jordan Knight.
But you also have a show coming up on the 17th?
Yes, the 17th. Oh, Bunker Hill Day to all you state workers like myself.
At the Linwood, which is on, so what's that, 69?
69 Kilmarock Street.
Kilmarock Street in Boston.
Right near Fenway Park.
Now, what time does that show start?
Come on, people. Winthrop has to support us. We don't go on until midnight.
Whoa.
Yeah, it's very late. sometimes, especially when you're a new group, you really got to take what's offered to you.
Right.
And we had to take it. We didn't have much of a choice. Unfortunately, the show that no one listening now can see, which is at the Kirkland over in Somerville, we go on at 10. That's tomorrow. Tomorrow being Wednesday at the time this is being taped. We go on at 10, so that would be perfect for people to go to. But, you know, we hope maybe some people come down and check us out. And we're working on some shows for July and August, possibly at the Midway Cafe and JP. And we're working on a Middle East show. And we're going to try to get another show at the Kirkland if tomorrow night goes well. And we have another couple places in mind that we sent some stuff out to. So we're trying to work it. It's tough being an original band, not a cover band.
Exactly.
And people have to realize that it's a lot of work, a lot of time, and we do the best we can. And we hope people support us. We try to put on a good show, and we have some good tunes, and we hope people can enjoy it.
Now, you mentioned your email address for getting in contact. Could you mention that again?
Sure. Mine is lynchmob, one word, lynchmob88@hotmail.com. And another email you could get a hold of would be our guitarist, Rob Palange. His email is roswell, with one L,
roswell.
1013@AOL.com. I'm pretty sure that's right. But to be on the safe side, you can email me at lynchmob88@hotmail.com. You can try Rob at that other address as well.
And you could get the CDs either through them or going to your show.
Going to the show, or we'll bring them to the show, yeah.
Or even if you want to try and get it through our show, the 10 Go to 10 show, you can, again, go to winthropma.com, click on WCAT, and then click on feedback and leave your message saying
the other guy will take care of you.
Yes. Also, do you guys have a web page up that they could reach you that way? Is there something up on the web?
We had one this time last year, then something happened. Actually, I don't handle the webpage aspect of it. I'm actually kind of new to computers. But we actually have one. Mike's been working on one. And, you know, I don't know what it is because he's not done with it yet. And it's off of his UMass thing he has. And it's I'm not even sure of it. But what you can do is email me. And then as soon as we get it, I'll let you know. And
yeah, maybe we can have you on a
follow up
show.
Or maybe if the other guy will play another one of our songs at some point in the future, he can.
Oh, definitely.
You could mention, you know, that he is if you're not in the room.
After tonight, this will be, you will already have half the CD played, five songs.
Yep. As I said, the other guy is very cool. He really lets independent groups, you know, be heard, and it's really appreciated.
And actually, on that note, if you have any material that you would like to have played on the show, I will be more than welcome to accommodate you. You can send your material to the 10 Go to 10 show at P.O. Box 426141, and that's in Cambridge, and the zip code is 02142. Actually, one last question, Mark. We were talking earlier about personnel changes. You did have a manager in the past. There was a change in that, right? Who...
Yeah, we had Joe Mara was helping us out, but okay. Joe isn't doing that anymore for us. So you can basically go through me at this point, or Rob. So any questions anyone has, you can just email me directly at lynchmob88@hotmail.com. and I will respond within a day or two. I promise.
We trust you.
And before you play that last song, I just want to say our last song that's going to be played tonight is a very traditional song with a verse, chorus, bridge, solo, chorus. And a lot of our songs aren't like that, so this song is kind of cool. I really like Gone to My Head as a song because I think it's a little different for us, even though it's more standard in terms of typical song structure.
And will this song be heard on these shows coming up?
Yep, actually, it's the last song we play. Because the last line of the song is "and now I'm gone," so it's kind of a good ending.
Aha!
And I hope everyone enjoys the songs that I picked to play. They're very songs you won't hear anywhere else, but right here on 10 Go to 10. So.
All right. Well, this is it. This is Gone to My Head, and we'll be back in a couple of minutes. Welcome back to the 10 Go to 10 show. My name is the other guy, and, well, we seem to get a little cut off there, so we're going to start the song off again. Again, this is Gone to My Head by Red Baron.
Take my shit, and you want more, and you want more.
Welcome back to the 10 Go to 10 show. That was Gone to My Head by Red Baron. I'm here again with Mark Lynch of the group, Red Baron, and he is the bassist. We're actually getting ready to say goodbye to Mark. Alas, he has to head out, get back to his personal life.
Yes.
Actually, I have one quick question, and if you can't answer this, maybe you could pass it along to your lead guitarist. He might actually be able to answer this. The question is, do eyeballs melt?
Oh, God. Yeah, I think Rob's more appropriate to answer that question.
Well, have him tune in if he can, and I think he might get a kick out of that, hopefully. I want to actually thank you, Mark, for coming on. You are actually my first guest on the show, and hopefully I'll get a few more, hopefully, at some point. But we try and, have a nice relaxed pace, hanging out. And hopefully you'll be back, or another member of your group will be on.
Sure, anytime. We'd love to. Thank you. Thanks for having me.
And actually, before you go, you are actually going to spin a couple of mystery songs for us.
Yes, it's three songs that I enjoy that you typically will not hear on the radio or MTV. And hope everyone enjoys them. And the other guy, I'll tell you what they are after. So if you're interested.
Or you.
Or me. Yeah.
And going along with how you like to do things, to introduce people.
As I said, to avoid any preconceived ideas, I'll just let these groups play and people can judge for themselves.
And this might be a little mind-blowing for some people when they do find out. So let's get right to it. You are listening to the 10 Go to 10 show right here on WCAT with the Community Access Television.
Springtime.
okay, we'll give you 5 seconds to give us your answers as to who did those last three songs. Give up? Okay, Mark, why don't you read back from first to last who those bands were and what the songs were.
All right, the first song was by a group called Enuff's Enuff, and it was called Believe in Love. It's off their brand new album, which just came out about a month ago. They're from Chicago. They have a very, I call it Beatles meets Cheap Trick type feel to them. And it was really tough picking a song off that album because there's about 9 or 10 songs out of the 14, which are really, really good songs, and I didn't know which one to play, but I just picked that one. The second song you heard was from a band called King's X. They've been around since 1987. I've seen them in concert a whole bunch of times.
They were here last
October.
October.
Actually, the other guy and I checked them out together.
Oh, yeah, excellent. Actually, I mentioned that on the show, past show, and I played a few songs off of several albums, so they're definitely worth checking out.
That tune was Over and Over. That's on their new album, Tapehead, which came out, I think, the end of October 98. So it's been out about seven, 8 months by now. They're on tour, they're a great show live. If you don't even know any of their songs, you go see them live, you'll be hooked.
Are they actually are they playing out right now again?
I think they are. I'm gonna keep my eyes open. They used to be on Atlantic. Now they're on Metal Blade. So they're out on tour with Galactic Cowboys, another really cool band.
Yep.
I think they might be doing another swing. So. I suggest
go check
seeing
them out.
Live. They're great live. And the last song you just heard was called Home Alone by a group called D.A.D. Used to be known as Disneyland After Dark. They're a Danish group. They're from Copenhagen. And that was off an import album, which I got. They have a couple of albums out here in the States from the late 80s, early 90s, but they're almost impossible to find. And they are huge in Europe. A lot of people say they're big in Canada. But D.A.D. is huge in Europe, and they never really caught on in the States, but they're a different band. They're another band that you never know what you're going to get when you play a song. The lyrics are always a little weird because English is not their first language, so it's always interesting to hear the way they...
Midnight Oil!
Right, the way they phrase things. Sometimes
it is catchy,
like,
though,
what?
The way...
Yeah, and again, that album, that's off an album called Simpatico. Actually, the title track is a great song. And there's about 3 or 4 other songs besides Home Alone and Simpatico that are just really outstanding. And, again, they're just a great group. There's so much stuff out there, like we were saying earlier, that you just don't hear.
You played that album for me once, and it's just unbelievable, you know, what's out there. But I wouldn't be surprised if you could find that album on that online CD now.
Right.
That you can get a lot of imports. And actually... stuff that was originally domestic, like albums by bands that were from the United States, a lot of other countries are putting them out, and you can get them as imports, even though they originally were from America.
Right.
But at least they're available. You might have to go through Australia to get it. But
right. Like, there's certain groups you didn't think existed anymore, like Enuff's Enuff, for instance.
Yeah.
And they've been consistently making records since 1987. And, you know, no one realizes it. And, you know, because of what their image was or what kind of clothes they wore at one point, someone might not take them seriously. But like I said, if you don't tell someone that and you just play the music for them. And
because
like,
they dressed a certain way, then everyone believed that that's their only thing.
Right.
And but they didn't, you know.
Right. And even when they did dress that way, the music was really good. But no one could see past an image. And, that's partially the band. Well, it's more actually the label's fault because they're trying to market to what they think is going to sell. But it's just, as we said, you know, a lot of things that are out there. And as you mentioned with imports, being a self-admitted metalhead, I know, for instance, in Japan, metal is huge. And it's always been huge. And even in parts of Europe, it's huge. Back maybe 3, 4, 4 or 5 years ago when grunge was big, there'd be a grunge festival with typical American grunge bands, and then a metal festival within a couple months of each other. And the metal festivals would consistently turn out almost twice as much.
Larger crowds over there.
By a lot.
Right.
And but here in the States, things are just so much more media.
It's just stagnant. It's just not even.
So not to say metal is the everyone likes their own thing. I mean, that's just a for instance.
Right.
that, you know, a lot of the music you hear, you're not going to, you know, hear on, for instance, 10 Go to 10, you're not going to hear on MTV. And that's not necessarily a bad thing. And I encourage people to seek out music like that. I think it only expands your
right.
Your knowledge.
Well, if anything, you'll hear it here first before it hits MTV. I mean, in special instances like Fatboy Slim.
Right.
Groups like that where it's literally like a year later that they actually start getting airplay, but yet they're advertising as, you know, brand new from Fatboy Slim. It's like, hello, you know, that was out 2 years ago
right. And how long
a single.
How long has Prodigy been around for?
Oh, God. I mean, it's...
right.
The
no,
thing,
but a lot of kids, the little mall kids, they don't realize this stuff. And they
only when they got, you know, the guy dressed with the
right with
the eyeliner and everything.
Right.
Yeah, that's, you know, when they got themselves a front man, that's when they actually gave themselves, you know, an image. But just a quick thing on the Japanese titles. That's one thing I noticed actually on that online service is that if you have a band, you know, for instance, I'm not going to name any bands, but... You know, a band has 10 albums, 9 of the 10 did really well, and then there's always that one album that didn't sell for some reason or another, whether it's a live album or just, you know, it just wasn't really, didn't appeal. You generally, you'll find that as an import.
Right.
It's usually from, it will say, like, this is a Japanese title or this is a, you know, from Belgium or something. But there's,
right.
there's like, a country out there that will actually still have
oh, yeah.
it more
and
than
I,
likely.
And I comb those bargain bins,
oh,
boy.
It's excellent. Oh.
I'm a rat when it comes to this.
Building 19, man. I'll admit
it. I have
it.
To check that out. I haven't been to Building 19 yet, but I was in even D.A.D., that group we just played. I found on disc their first album issued in America back in 89, which was supposed to break them in America, but it didn't. I thought I'd never, ever be able to find it again. And it was sitting in a record store on Comm Ave, and I stumbled on it. It was new, too. It wasn't even used. And I was like, wow!
Yep.
And I snapped that right off, like $2. I snapped that right up. And it's a great album. And it's just...
I don't go
maybe
higher
I'm a freak.
Than,
I don't know.
We don't go higher than $4. Oh, boy. No, but yeah, it was real fun having you on, Mark. And I do appreciate you spending... Oodles of time now.
Hey, we had fun. And again, everyone come out and see us on June 17th at the Linwood.
Yep. And they go on
Red
at
Baron.
Midnight. So, but come early. You know, there's a cheap beer.
Oh, yeah. I think it's $5
actually,
to get in. And the booze is cheap.
Okay.
So 21,
it's
21 plus.
Okay.
Yeah,
21 plus. Sorry. Sorry.
If it wasn't.
Yep.
It's 21 plus. And
but
it's like $5 to get in. You'll have a good time.
And if you're under 21, you can still get their album. You can contact Mark or one of the other guys at, if you want to just once more read off your emails.
Sure, my email is lynchmob, one word, 88@hotmail.com. So it's lynchmob88@hotmail.com.
All right, Mark. Well, again, thanks. And I look forward to seeing you on the 17th because, you know I'll be there. You are listening to the 10 Go to 10 show right here on WCAT. We're going to continue. Actually, there's one thing I do have to mention. I had actually started the show off a little bit differently. I had played a few songs, but I didn't really count on the interview going as long as it did. But because we were having such a good in-depth conversation, we had to switch things around. So actually, in the past interview, you heard me mentioning that I played like Alice Cooper and maybe some other groups. And I read off a playlist actually at the beginning of the other side, which was actually side B. But now this is side B and the other side is side A. So we had to flip things around to sort of make space for the interview session, which I was all for anyway, so it's no big deal. So it's a little bit confusing, but I'm going to try and make up or fit in as many songs as I had already mentioned in the remaining minutes that we have on this show. So I'm going to start off right now actually with a band from New Zealand called The Bats. This track is off of their Couchmaster album, which came out a few years ago. And this track is called Land of Lakes. Hope you like it.
Thank you. here I go again, up and down alone. All my friends went home years ago. The carnival has closed years ago.
Whispers and screams of pain. if that's the way that God has planned you. I'll put pennies on your eyes.
Pretty much going to do it for this week's late night edition of the 10 Go to 10 show. Let me just quickly read off what I just played on the last set, starting off with the Bats with Land of Lakes, a couple of tracks by My Bloody Valentine from their Loveless album. We heard Loomer and Only Shallow. We also heard two tracks from Alice Cooper as well off of his Welcome to My Nightmare album. We heard Years Ago and Steven. And that was pretty much it. We're going to leave off with a song from a local group. They're called Soothing Sounds for Baby. The name of the track is New Year's Restoration. And I promise that I will get to the other songs that I had originally played before the switcheroo for to make room for the interview. I will play those on next week's show. So you will hear Psychic Warriors and Underworld. And again, I would like to thank my guest from tonight, Mark Lynch of Red Baron fame. And be sure and catch them this 17th at the Linwood, and check them out. They're going on at midnight. So again, my name is The Other Guy, and the name of the show is 10 Go to 10 right here on WCAT. We'll see you next week.